Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Jeremiah, what seest thou? And I said, I see, but this is what I see, the rod of an almond tree. Verse 12. Then saith the Lord unto me, thou hast seen well, for I will hasten. My God. So there is a relationship between speed and vision. The moment you see well, you compel speed in your life. Because you have seen correctly, I will hasten. I was going to perform it anyway, but on the strength of the clarity of your vision, I will hasten my word to perform it. Genesis chapter 13, verse 14 and 15. Genesis chapter 13, we're discussing vision. The Lord said unto Abraham, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thy eyes and look from the place where a clear picture of the next level of your life, a clear picture of your destiny. This is very powerful. There are many well-meaning believers, born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, and they have ignored the power of vision to the detriment of their progress. Vision is powerful. A clear picture of the next level of your life. It is in this area that both science and religion agree that without vision there is no movement. Motion is a function of vision. There is no car that does not have a provision to look at. There is no plane, no matter how managed, they must give space, because sight is what controls movement. The pilot must see. The driver must see. The captain must see. I don't know any creature that has his eyes backward. Every creature I know has the eyes forward. Because you only move in the direction of your eyes. Vision is powerful. Please listen carefully. The vision for my life. This ministry continues to make giant strides in the spirit because your pastor has a vision, very clear vision. Are we together now? Now, as powerful as vision is, it does not profit you just remaining as vision. You must break your vision into goals and break your vision into daily tasks. Until your vision becomes daily tasks, it will only remain a dream in the realm of the spirit. There are people who have done well in terms of writing a theme that seems to coordinate their lives, but were unable to break the visions into goals. What is a goal? A desired end, an expected end, a subset of that vision. And you break it into tasks. There is an energy, there is a power that vision gives. When you break your vision into tasks, it gives you focus. Vision gives you the legitimate ground to say no to many things. There are many things you will not be able to have the courage to say no to until you have vision. Vision gives you the legitimate ground to say no to many things. If you are not a man of vision, you are not a woman of vision, you will not have the courage to say no to so many things. And there are many things. 24 hours was given to you with respect to your vision. So time will never be enough to mix your vision alongside many distractions. You will have to cut away so many things to give you the time and to give you focus. Can I tell you this? The unit of destiny is time. Whatever you give your time to, you are giving part of your life to. And you must be sure that every minute and every second you commit to anything is worth that while. Everybody say vision. Show me a man who has nothing working in his life but vision. I show you a man who is already walking his way to a dimension of kingdom influence, dimension of grace that no principality and power can stop. Vision is powerful. I do not know any leader who is not visionary. Even the devil is visionary. He has been clear about his assignment. Even Jesus testified about the dexterity of Satan's assignment. That anytime you see him, he is there to steal, to kill, to destroy. There's no record of him coming to advise. There's no record of him coming. Anytime the thief cometh not, that means he has no business coming except this singular vision. No wonder he seems to be succeeding. The law is so powerful. Could it be that we are where we are right now because we are hoping God will find a way of just lifting us? Very, very spiritual, but very wrong. Some of those superstitious thinkings, in the name of Jesus, the Son of the Living God, be delivered from it now. We have many sociological wise sayings. They look spiritual because they've been handed down by well-intentioned people. But these things are, they give access to the devil to blind our minds and our progress. One day it go better. You've heard that kind of saying. I know my God is too faithful to just leave me like that. You are right. But with respect to this truth, you are wrong. I introduce to you the God of systems. Hoping that your life will change just because he's alive. Let me tell you this. There are many children, there are many people who are dying. If God were to act, he would attend to them first before he comes to you. Even at the detriment of your eternal salvation, he did not interrupt your choice. There are people today who woke up this morning, but as we speak, they are in hell now. And yet God is still seated on his throne. So hoping that one day something will just happen is a joke. You have to prophesy to yourself, myself, wake up. One day I will have a global ministry. One day in the name of Jesus I will bless people. Wonderful. Congratulations. Except for the fact that it will only remain a wish in the realm of the spirit. Let me tell you the difference between a wish and a goal. A wish is a desire with no responsibility commitment to it. When you set a goal, it is a strong desire that is backed up with the willingness to commit whatever it takes under God to actualize that goal. Responsibility is the key word. If all you have is just a desire, it will never come to pass. Your desire must be able to sponsor the willingness to pay whatever price under God to see that it comes to pass. Are we together? You call it gaining momentum. So where the plane is only warming up. Vision. I am amazed, Pastor, at how many Christians, respectfully speaking, live absolutely visionless lives. People just move up and down and blame God for everything. When they can't see God, they blame pastors who they can see for everything, and then blame parents, blame every... Now, I understand that sometimes these things can be emotionally overwhelming. But the day you start moving forward is the day you take responsibility over your destiny and say, in the name of Jesus, I'm tired giving excuses. In the name of Jesus, I'm tired of legitimizing the continuity of mediocrity and weakness in my life. I respect and I sympathize with your background. I sympathize with the fact that you came from a family that was not very responsible. I sympathize with you, but wake up. From where thou art, lift up your eyes. For as long as you keep looking down, you will soon find your children looking with you. You will soon find your grandchildren joining them to look with you. Many of our parents, respectfully speaking, kept complaining until we now join them in that complaint. You make up your mind in this conference that my children will not find me there. In the name of Jesus Christ. There are few people historically speaking, who had the leverage to be able to rise to positions of influence and notoriety. Most people had to speak to themselves right from where they were. You ask your pastor, he will tell you that there were times he had to just shut away and say, look, it's time for us to move forward. I remember talking with a man, very great and influential man, and this man told me, Apostle, would you believe that as at the time I married my wife, I had to give her one of my big shirts when she was pregnant. That means you remove your shirt and say, wife, there's no buying, those gowns. Said, I don't have the money for that. Don't expect anything there, but thank God I'm bigger than you. We can make do with this. The Lord will prosper us in the future. Now, that man would have given a careless excuse and now mentored the child and say, young man, let me tell you how you arrived. Let me tell you the story. And the child in anger and pain will remain there, become a teenager, become an adult, marry his own wife and say, don't blame me for being irresponsible. I'm continuing something. There is a history to this. There has to be someone who will break that cycle. And it comes with the power of vision. What seest thou? As for me, I see a life of glory. In the name of Jesus, I see an opportunity to wake up every morning, transforming a generation, blessing a people. For someone, you are seeing a company that God has been speaking to you. You have refused to write it. You have refused to take it serious. The Holy Ghost works like a woman. If he tries to give you his attention and you ignore it, he will step back until he discerns seriousness from you again. Many of you, the reason why God stops showing you certain things is because he traced that you don't take his speaking serious. Abraham, come out of your father's house. The first assignment is come out. Come out of your father's house. He came from a land of wizardry and witchcraft, or of the Chaldeans, and he called that traditionally. He said, come out of your father's house, from your kindred, from everything, to a land that I will show you. The transformation started when he changed what he was seeing. May grace to be visionary rest upon your life. Hear me. You may be in that one room now. There's no point faking what can be real. Just be patient with your destiny. You see, the powerful thing about vision is that it has the power of omnipresence. You can be in a room and your vision can be where you will be tomorrow. The imagination is powerful. It can go. You can't. Listen. Your vision works with your imagination and it can go to your future. Make sure it supervises that future is real. It will come back and take your body there.